here we are. Yeah, so it's a small and select audience of people here. I'm very pleased to talk about something that I feel rather passionate about. And I'm sure that if Gianni was here, he would like this as well, because this is one of the interfaces where an imaging person gets to see patients and look after patients, and that can add a dimensionality to our practice, which I think is very exciting. I've never personally been more excited to be involved in nuclear medicine than I am right at the moment, because of the evolution of Theranostics and our ability to use imaging to chart patient pathways. This is our new hospital in Melbourne. It's a beautiful building, but it's also the site of quite a large Theranostic program. These are my disclosures. When we think about the some would say archaic temple of therapeutic oncology, we have a number of therapeutic pillars that are available to us. In a recent JCO article, they had five of these pillars, and they left out one that I think is rather important: radionuclide therapy. Surgery's obviously been with us for thousands of years, from at least the time of the Egyptians, but probably before that. Radiotherapy around the turn of the 20th century, the early 1900s, and radionuclide therapy not long after that. Chemotherapy came in the middle of the 20th century, targeted therapies at the start of the 21st century, and just in the last few years we've seen this emergence of immunotherapy. So I'm going to focus on radionuclide therapy. When we're selecting any of these therapies, the key determinants, the pediment on which temple stands, have been accurate diagnosis about the extent of disease, which has usually been the province of imaging, and the characterization of disease, which has really been the domain of pathology. But increasingly, molecular imaging can start to bridge that gap in also characterizing the nature of disease. Therapeutic nuclear medicine is not new. It actually started with a serendipitous accident, if you like, radiation accident, that Pierre Curie was taking a sample of radium in his breast pocket to give a lecture at the Sorbonne, and he got a burn on his chest, which took a long time to heal, and he went and saw a friend of his who was a dermatologist, who had the idea that this might be a really good way to treat skin cancers by applying it directly onto the skin cancers. That was Henri Alexandre Denlot, and he used it for the treatment of skin diseases. And Australians have always been relatively early adopters. This is a book that was published in Melbourne of BCC treatment, before and after pictures, and squamous cell carcinoma of the soft palate, also responding to radium. So this was one of the first effective treatments of tumours. The problem is you had to be able to get to them. One of the big advances in therapeutic nuclear medicine was the development of the cyclotron, and most of you would be aware of the cyclotron as producing PET radiopharmaceuticals. But in fact, before there was any PET imaging, the cyclotrons were used to make therapeutic radionuclides. One of the first of those was P32. Actually, the brother of Ernest Lawrence, who invented the cyclotron, was a hematologist. And one of the PhD students in the Lawrence lab was injecting P32 into the vein and measuring it pass through the heart with the Geiger-Müller counter and then appear in the other side of the body to do a cardiac circulation time as a measure of cardiac function. And after a few experiments like this, they were starting to see the patients becoming anemic and their blood counts dropping. And he mentioned this to his brother, who said, well, I've got these patients who've got these leukemias, these chronic leukemias, and one of them was a medical student. Medical students are always up for experiments. So he injected P32, and that became one of the first effective treatments for hematologic malignancy. Subsequently, Glenn Seaborg started making iodine, and that led to the treatment of thyroid cancer by Sam Seedland more than 75 years ago, and thyrotoxicosis by Saul Hertz. And if we look at how Sam Seidlin did it, he used a Geiger-Müller counter again to identify these lesions and measure the counts in each of the sites of disease over a period of time. And he worked out from that how much you needed to give to get a therapeutic effect. And the idea was if you could measure it, you could treat it. Imaging, as we know it in molecular imaging, came way after those therapeutic interventions. The rectilinear scan, the ability to see the thyroid, was the next change. And so the idea, and that became first involved with the treatment of with radioactive iodine, the idea that linking a therapy to a diagnostic is what Theranostics is, and using the imaging then to monitor the effectiveness of the treatment you've given. And the perfect paradigm of Theranostics, and something that most clinicians are aware of, is the use of radioactive iodine to image the extent of remnant thyroid tissue, to detect distant metastatic disease, to monitor the patients with a combination of a blood biomarker, in this case thyroglobulin. Thyroglobulin's raised, where is the disease? And the imaging tells you, you give a single treatment with that and it goes away. You follow them up with a combination of imaging. The problem, and so the basic summary of Theranostics, if you can see it, you can treat it. However, we've learned that sometimes you can't see it, that the target that we need for therapeutic intervention is lacking. And sometimes even when we can see some sites, we don't see all sites. So this is a patient of ours who presented with back pain. And you can see, if you just do the scan on the left, the iodine scan, you think this patient's perfectly suitable for radioactive iodine therapy. There's lots of areas of black stuff that are the disease. But when we look at the CT scan, there's a very big soft tissue mass eroding a thoracic vertebra there. And when we do an FDG scan on this, we see completely different biodistribution. So we've got, in one patient, heterogeneity of target expression. Some disease you can see, some you can't. So if you can't see it, you can't treat it. It's an important parameter to recognise in the theranostic paradigm. Why can't we see it? And that comes back to biology, and molecular imaging is whole body biological imaging. We now know the pathways that drive the expression of the sodium iodide symporter. So we were treating patients with iodine before we knew how it got into cells or what drove the expression of that particular target. We now know that there's a very important pathway called the MAP kinase pathway. Coincidentally, very commonly expressed in our national disease, which is melanoma. About 45% of melanomas have BRAF mutations, the V600E mutation, but it's also present in a subgroup of thyroid cancers that become dedifferentiated. And in the process of becoming dedifferentiated, they have a major effect on metabolic reprogramming. They upregulate glycolytic metabolism through HIF alpha, which is a hypoxia-driven gene, which downstream leads to overexpression of the GLUT transporter and increases FDG or glucose use. And of course, you get increased FDG avidity if you have that. But it also downregulates expression of the sodium iodide symporter, that transporter which is critical to the uptake of iodine in thyroid cancers. And so you have this phenotype of high glycolytic activity and low iodine uptake, and so we're now recognising that because of the importance of that pathway that maybe we can modulate it. And so this is a patient who, if you look at the CT scan, there's clearly a nodule in the lung, in fact a number of nodules in the lung on the baseline CT that had low or absent iodine avidity. Coincidentally, because we saw those, we did an FDG scan and that showed high FDG avidity in those lesions. The patient was genotyped and found to have a V600E mutation, and so we put the patient on a drug that blocks the next gene downstream of that, which is MEK, a MEK inhibitor called trametinib. And if you look at those two scans and we're thinking about sensitivity of detection, you would say this patient has progressed. But if you look at the CT, you can see that the lesion has got smaller. They've actually responded to treatment. The lesions are shrinking, but we've turned back on the target for radioactive iodine therapy, which is the sodium iodide symporter. And because we can see it, we can now treat it. And this patient was treated with quite successfully with radioactive iodine. So we've taken a patient from an incurable, untreatable stage to a treatable and potentially curable stage. So if you can understand the mechanisms that drive our phenotype, we can modulate it potentially with drugs. And this is a theme I'll come back to, that a lot of theranostics in the future, I think, is going to be in combination with other treatments that upregulate receptors or combined different agents to deal with subpopulations of cells that we can't target with radionuclides. Our experience with theranostics was largely driven also by experience with the somatostatin receptor. The somatostatin receptor is like a key, if you like, like the door into a neuroendocrine cell. The key to that door is peptides that bind to the receptor. We have key rings, which are the chelating agents, and we have dangly bits, which are the radionuclides. And most therapeutic radionuclides have that combination of a key, something that hangs a dangly bit off, and it's the dangly bits that give the attraction, I think, of these radionuclides. And we call this peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. The idea is it can hang a whole lot of different dangly bits off the octreotide. It comes into the cell and causes DNA damage, hopefully double-strand DNA breaks, which are lethal to the tumour. That concept of molecular imaging being not about finding lumps, not about sensitivity, but about the specificity of the molecular target is really important. These are two patients with neuroendocrine tumours, one with a very low-grade neuroendocrine tumour and the other one with a high-grade tumour. If we look at the gallium octreotide scan, which we call GATTATE scan because it's the dangly bit and the key that matter, not the key ring. Some people call them DOTA scans, which doesn't make any sense to me. But if we look at those two patients and we put them in a group, how many lesions do we see? If we do a group sensitivity, it's 50%. 100% in one patient and 0% in the other. But what matters here is the one on the left can be treated with peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. The one on the right cannot be. And similarly, if we do FDG scans, the sensitivity is 50%. We see 50% in the scans on the right and zero in the scans on the left. But the reality is that they're two fundamentally different diseases. They're telling us about heterogeneity and the phenotype, which reflects and guides our treatment choices. The one on the right needs chemotherapy because they have a more biologically aggressive disease. And so it's uncommon to actually see so strikingly discordant, all positive on one and negative on the other. It took me actually a long time to find that. Most patients have a combination of both, and like this patient. So if we only do the GATTATE scan for somatostatin, you say this patient's perfectly suitable. And on first glance, most of those deposits are also FDG avid, but when we look at it in a more detailed way, you can see that there are discordant areas that are FDG avid that lack somatostatin receptors. We call them spatially discordant. And those spatially discordant disease cannot be targeted with PRRT. The patient will never benefit from PRRT because the most aggressive clones are not targeted. And if you don't know they're there, the patient will progress. You'll think your treatment hasn't worked, and the patient will obviously die of their aggressive disease. And so we're increasingly starting to use these images to guide our biopsies to these discordant areas to understand the molecular basis of those phenotypic differences to try and identify different therapeutic targets in these patients. So if we can see it and characterise its phenotype, we can also understand it, and that's a very important message. I hope you'll get the idea of potentially targeting not on the basis of anatomy and accessibility, but perhaps on the basis of molecular phenotype. If we look at response, similarly, we can see differential responses in different subpopulations of cells, even when they're all expressing the same target. So here's a patient who obviously has had a very nice response to peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, marked shrinkage of tumour, but two sites of residual disease, one in the pancreas and a small one just above the right kidney there, in a patient with a high-grade neuroendocrine tumour. Most of the world would not treat this patient with PRRT. They say they're not suitable for therapy because they have aggressive disease. We felt the same way. Aggressive disease, highly FDG avid, likely to be poor prognosis. Ki-67 50% means half the cells were in active cycling phase, which is a quite aggressive tumour. Patient had chemotherapy, and you can see the FDG showing clear progression of disease morphologically and no metabolic response in this patient. Following PRRT, even though we know there was still residual disease in the pancreas and the liver, the FDG signal went away because the highly proliferative FDG-avid disease, which is targeted, is actually more radiosensitive than the well-differentiated disease. And so if we schematically consider the a priori likelihood of somatostatin receptor expression in a tumour, it decreases as tumour grade increases and it falls, so that green line of somatostatin receptor expression falls as you get up into the high-grade tumours. Conversely, FDG signal as a measure of aggressiveness generally will increase as tumour grade increases. There are, however, some low-grade tumours that have FDG, probably driven by hypoxia rather than by proliferation, but it's still telling you something about the biology that makes them rather resistant to treatment. Obviously, the red zone is unsuitable for our targeted therapy because the target simply isn't there. The green ones are the ones that most people are treating, but perhaps they don't need it because they're not actively growing, and perhaps they could be watched. But the ones who need it and most likely to benefit are those with higher grade, because radiosensitivity and chemosensitivity increase with increasing proliferation. That's why we use chemotherapy and radiotherapy in aggressive cancers, because the cells are actively growing. And the prognosis, conversely, goes down because of those same things. So the patients who really benefit are those who are in that orange zone. And we've deliberately chose that colour scheme because it speaks to us. And this used not to work in Italy. It works now. At least in Verona, people do stop at red lights. They used not to, in my experience, when you have a red light, don't proceed. Green, you can go ahead, but the most enjoyable thing is to get through the amber light before it's red. So we treat those patients who are FDG avid and somatostatin up front. We tend to watch the ones who are in the green zone. The next thing that's really important to Theranostics is the ability to do assessment of how likely they are to benefit from it. A lot of people say that dosimetry isn't important. I tend to disagree. There's no treatment that hasn't had a dose response curve. It may not be very accurate, but at least if we can measure it, we can start to understand it. And so one of my fellows who had a background in physics and subsequently one of our medical physicists has developed a technique for quantitative SPECT CT so that we can do post-treatment dose verification and can start to understand why some patients respond and others do not. But we also need to recognise perhaps we can personalise therapy by measuring what we get. And so here's a series of four post-treatment scans done with quantitative SPECT, and you can see the cumulative dose to tumours in this particular patient was over 100 gray to their lesions, with the off-target radiation being rather low. Over the course of the treatment, clearly the burden of disease got much less, And you say, well, that's expected. If you're giving 100 gray of radiation to lesions, you'd expect them to respond. But what we did in this patient was to decrease our administered activity in parallel with the reduction in tumour burden. And the reason for that was that if we hadn't, we would have started to significantly increase, and we were already starting to increase the radiation dose to off-target tissues, particularly the hematopoietic stem cells in the marrow and spleen. In this very radiosensitive tumour, as the population of somatostatin receptor expressing cells was diminishing, so too was the absorbed dose in the tumour. And so we bailed out of treatment in this particular patient. Here's another patient who also got 100 gray plus to their reference sites, but you can see that the regression over the course of this treatment was much less. And in this particular case, the radiation dose was maintained throughout the course of treatment, so we were able to deliver more radiation to radio-resistant cell lines. So if we can measure it, we can potentially improve our therapeutic index. And this patient actually went on to have another two cycles of treatment and had a very good response. One of the things that is very important one of the tools that we have available to us are a range of different dangly bits that have different biological characteristics. Yttrium has a much longer path length and therefore gives much higher radiation dose, not only to big lesions, but also around tumours. And once you get to about 4 centimetres, the amount of radiation inside a tumour relative to outside is very beneficial in terms of radiation delivery. And this is a series of patient scans where we've estimated the radiation dose to that particular lesion is over 200 gray. If you get 200 gray into a tumour, it's likely to respond. And so here we see the before and after pictures showing a complete metabolic response, or almost complete metabolic response, and also an excellent morphologic response. And in the group of patients with bulky disease, using this combination therapy of using the long path length yttrium up front and following it as the tumours start to shrink with lutetium, we've had the best overall survival of any population, even though these are the worst prognostic group that we treat. And you can see whether you use PET volume or RECIST response, these patients have an excellent response. Ideally, we'd like to be able to measure dose before we give it. We can't take it back, we can't give more. So post-treatment dose verification is not as good as prognostic pre-treatment dosimetry. But to do that, you need a radionuclide that stays there long enough to measure cumulative activity over a period of time. And so we've done some work using copper 64, which has a 13-hour half-life roughly, which enables us to do multi-time point imaging out to beyond 24 hours that can enable us to do prospective dosimetry. And we can also pair that with copper 67, which is a beta-emitting radionuclide that has almost the same energy and half-life as lutetium, and we think will be a very good combination. How might some of you as radiologists get involved in this area? One of the things that we think is really a way of further improving the therapeutic index is to use interventional radiology to deliver it into the bloodstream. These have high extraction fraction, and so giving it either directly into the hepatic arteries when there's liver-dominant disease, or in the case of meningioma, directly into feeder vessels. As you can see, there is a significant increase in the intensity of uptake when it's given intra-arterially, and that will increase the therapeutic index for these patients. So the better you can see it, the more radiation it's likely to get, and the more radiation you give to the tumour, the more likely it is to respond. And so this is a comparison of one of our patients with intravenous GATTATE, the diagnostic agent, intra-arterial GATTATE into the right artery, hepatic artery, and you can see how much the intensity has increased by that approach. And so we tend to use this in patients with liver dominant disease. So the better you can see it, again, the more radiation it gets. But do we stop with somatostatin receptors? We know that not all neuroendocrine tumours have somatostatin receptors, but there are other receptors like the cholecystokinin receptor and the GLP-1 receptor. Insulinoma is one, but most insulinomas tend to flip-flop from having the GLP-1 receptor to having somatostatin receptors when they become aggressive. But other tumours, like atypical carcinoid in our experience, tend to have low somatostatin receptor expression. So this is a patient with a relatively low-grade tumour. It's neither FDG avid nor expressing somatostatin. So it doesn't fit onto my graph of the grades of disease. It has neither of those targets. But when we look at the cholecystokinin 2 receptor ligand with a new tracer called CPO4, you can see incredibly intense uptake in that. And that becomes a new therapeutic target. And so a lot of the work that we're doing now is to look at new targets for treatment. PSMA is obviously an area of interest, a high uptake. And because it's got high uptake, we can have a therapeutic radionuclide. We can similarly measure radiation dose in those, so if we can see it, we can treat it. If you can get enough radiation into it, it's likely to respond, particularly because most prostate cancer is actively growing. It grows quickly, and therefore we get very good responses in these patients, sometimes really dramatic responses. The tumour for each of these pair of scans is segmented and shown in orange-red, and the post-treatment scans, these are the top responders in our prospective trial, won the image of the year at the Society of Nuclear Medicine meeting, and that correlated with reduction in biomarker, the PSA. But are our results real? Have they been recapitulated elsewhere? This is the German results, and our results seem to be much better than theirs in terms of PSA response. Why are they different? The reason, I think, is that most people treat on the basis of that scan. And of course, the patient's got lots of PSMA avid disease, but they also have lots of FDG avid disease, and they have the same discordant phenotype that we saw. And so if patients have low PSMA expression or discordant disease, we're not going to get good results from theranostic application. And so in the group of patients who we didn't treat on our trial, the patients who lack the target, the prognosis was awful. The survival was only 2.5 months. Even if we did treat them, if we couldn't get enough dose into them, they're much less likely to respond. So the patient's got less than 10 gray. Their overall response was very, very poor. So, as I said, there's lots of different dangly bits that we can use that have different physical activities, and that's going to be a really exciting area for us to develop. And there's also new targets. This is a fibroblast activating protein that you'll hear a lot about, FAPI. Very exciting tracer because there's almost no uptake in any other tissue than tumours. Not all tumours, but some of them that are not FDG but have this target, and so that can become potentially a therapeutic target. It's developed in Heidelberg and some really exciting work coming out of that. So what do we need to advance theranostic? Obviously, we need scientists that we work with new technologies or ideas. We need to have physicians who have an open mind. Fortunately or unfortunately, there are a lot of patients who lack therapeutic options. We also need a regulatory environment which is open to risk-taking, because at the end of the day, it's those patients who lack therapeutic options who should be demanding access to new therapies. So therapeutic medicine has a strong future, I think, if we remain engaged and brave. And with that, I'll thank my team, the lab and the molecular imaging, and also the people who fund us. Thank you very much.